हेलो, आई एम डॉक्टर करिश्मा चावला। मैंने एमपीटी ऑर्थो।
लेट्स नाउ कम टू द मेन टॉपिक, दैट इज योर कंजेनाइटल रेडियो अल्नर सिनोस्ट्रोसिस। ओके, व्हाट इज कंजेनाइटल रेडियो अल्नर सिनोस्ट्रोसिस? इट इज रेडियो अल्नर सिनोस्ट्रोसिस। दैट मीन्स बिटवीन द रेडियस एंड अल्ना देयर इज एन ऑस्टियोसिस, देयर इज अ फ्यूजन फॉर्म्ड। Okay, it is synosteosis, that means it is not able to divide properly and there is still a fusion between the radius and ulna. Okay, a fusion has developed between radius and ulna. This is radio ulnar synostosis. Okay, it is a very rare disorder. Most of the congenital disorders are rare. You will find very less children, thankfully. But it is very important to understand these disorders because these are the ones which will be difficult to assess. Okay, so if you don't know, if you don't read about these and the patient comes, what will happen? You will do the stretchings, you will do everything and nothing will happen. Nothing, you are not going to know about the where the problem lies, where the problem occurred. So you're not going to treat them properly, and plus these congenital disorders are the ones which are very good topics for your researchers. Okay, if you find even one case of a congenital, rare congenital disorder, so you can present a case study and you can do your research on one case itself. So they are very important in terms of your research purposes also. You should know about all these congenital disorders. Okay, then now let's come to how these are, what are the types of these congenital disorders. Okay, this radio ulnar synostosis, these can happen congenitally as we discussed, okay, during the development, or it can happen, the synostosis can happen traumatically also. If there is trauma to the radius and when the bone was healing, it started ossifying and went into fusion. There is a malunion. Okay. So, at that time also it can develop, and that is your traumatic synostosis. Now, in the congenital synostosis, what are the symptoms that you are going to see? Okay. So, there is, just imagine, there is a fusion over here. Okay. There is a fusion over here. So, for pronation to occur in my arm, what will happen? This radius has to come over ulna. It has to come over ulna to do the pronation movement, right? If there is a fusion, will it be able to come? No, it will not be able to come. So, that is why the patient is not able to do pronation movement, okay? Or there is very less pronation movement, or the pronation movement is by compensation. Either the patient is going to lift the shoulders, or it is going to hyper rotate the wrist. Okay, that is how the movement is happening, but it is not happening purely like this. Okay, because the radius is not able to cross over the ulna, because there is a fusion over here. So, supination pronation is not going to be there. Okay, but now tell me, if there is a fusion over here, will it affect the flexion and extension? No, it will not affect the flexion extension. Flexion extension is going to be easy. Okay, but still we see patients who are having some 5 degree, 10 degrees of lack over here, or we are seeing patients who are having some difficulty or some uneasiness in doing flexion extension also. Why? When there is no reason for this, then why are they having it? Can someone answer? Okay. It actually happens because our flexion is not happening just because of biceps. Okay, biceps is able to work properly, but it is not happening just because of biceps. Okay. This action is done by which muscle? This is done by brachioradialis. And this by brachialis. So, brachialis and brachioradialis is also responsible for flexion. Okay. When they are not helping, because this movement is not there, when these muscles are not helping, so the flexion is going to be relatively weak and they are going to have some irritation or some pain over here. Okay. And secondly, because there is an ossification, that ossification might impinge upon some thecal sac, or it can impinge upon some nerves. Okay. It can impinge upon the capsule also. That is the reason why you can have pain over here. Okay. Then sometimes the patient is going to have pain. In most of the cases, they are going to have pain over the shoulder region and the wrist also. Why? Because they are overcompensating with this wrist and shoulder movement. Okay. That is why they are going to have more pain over here. Okay. Now, you must have already guessed the reason why this synostosis happened. It happened at the stage, as I told you, when the humerus, radius and ulna had to be made from a one single cartilaginous structure. Okay. So that one single cartilaginous structure, when it divided into three structures at the eighth week, okay, at the eighth week when it was divided into three structures, might have made the humerus, it might have made the ulna, when it was, it might have even made the radius, but when it had to divide into two, into radius and ulna, it might have divided from the distal end, but it was not able to get separated at the proximal end. Okay, that is why it remained fused. Okay, so that is the reason why this was formed. Okay, then you can have certain associated disorders, like you can have club foot, you can have congenital dislocation of the hip, or you can have syndactyly and polydactyly, as I told. Okay, during the development you can have syndactyly. In most of the cases, surgery is not an option. Okay, surgery is not a very successful option. The surgeries are only recommended to the patients who are having major problems in their ADLs, or if they are having a bilateral disorder, okay, and there is no other way they can compensate for the function movement. Okay. And secondly, why surgeries are not recommended? It is because of family's apprehension, because there are going to be more number of side effects, like compartment syndrome, like nerve retraction. Okay. So these are the side effects that can happen, and they are more major as compared to the disorder which is present right now. And secondly, the success rate of the surgery is not very much. Even after surgery, the patient is going to have the functional deficit, some kind of functional deficit. Okay. So as physiotherapist, what do we play a role? Okay, how do we play a role? We have to provide a splint first. Okay, first we have to assess the patient. We have to assess the patient for the range of motion. Okay, so we have to know the pronation and supination. We have to know the flexion and extension. Flexion and extension is going to be more or less full. But the pronation and supination is going to be a problem. We have to see for the congenital history, the gestational history of the mother, did she, or the genetic history, did any kind of genetic disorders there, some developmental disorders, some person in the family is having club foot, club hand, or anything like that. Okay, then if there was any insert at the time of delivery, all these things have to be asked. And then, was there any trauma or not? If there is a trauma, it could be a traumatic reason why the it could be some kind of fracture or something. Okay, if there is no such trauma, okay, and this is happening on its own, and the child has suddenly started complaining of it at the age of 5, 6, 7, when he has learned that there is some problem, I'm not able to write like this, okay, or I'm not able to do the stuff the other children are doing, okay, and that time you can suspect it is some kind of congenital disorder. Then what happens? You have to order for an x-ray, you have to order for a radiograph, and radiograph you have to order for, you have to ask for a PA view and a lateral view. Okay. In the PA view, you can see that there is a fusion between the radius and ulna. Okay. And you can provide, once it is made that it is a synostosis, which is very easy to assess after once you have learned and once you have an x-ray, then you can see, I will attach an x-ray over here somewhere. Okay, you can see there is a fusion between the radius and ulna, and then after once you have made that there is fusion between radius and ulna, then you have to provide a splint in the supine position. Okay, you have to provide a splint in the supine position. That splint is going to be a night splint mostly, and then you have to assess for the your strength. Okay, strength of the forearm muscles. You can assess for the strength of the muscles through your MMT, or you can do a functional assessment through your hand gripper. You can, and with this functional assessment, you can see what difference it is making. Your treatment is effective or not. Okay, so with hand gripper, you can see the springs, you can increase the springs and you can see, okay. Then you can use your Jamar dynamometer if you are doing for a research purposes. For your hand functional assessment, you can use the Jepstra-Taylor hand function test. Then you can use your pinch strength meter, okay. For your research purposes, or otherwise you can just test in a MMT manner. Okay, then one, and for functional ADL assessment, you can use your SF36 questionnaire. Okay, so once you have made clear, now you come to the PT treatment. You can start by your splint at the night, and in the morning you can do with some exercises which involves supination and pronation. Okay, PNF patterns in supination and pronation, starting stretching of the supinator muscle. Okay, hold relax of the supinator muscle. Then you can have an elastic band tied on the both sides. You can make a loop, and you can ask the patient to do like this. Okay, hand is like this. You have to ask the patient to go further and rotate the arm as they are going further, like this. Okay, you can ask them to do like this into different directions: diagonal, lateral, upwards, diagonal, upwards. Okay, all these positions you can ask the patient to do the wall. Then you can ask the patient to do the wall clock exercises. Okay, you can ask the patient, then after wall clock exercises, the patient can bear weight on the arms in sitting and shift the weight. Okay, then you have to ask the patient to bear weight in a quadruped position and raise the leg for progression. Then for progression, you can ask the patient to do Superman positions. Okay, then you can have the patient do functional movements like opening the jar, closing the jar, opening the knob, closing the knob, all those functional activities, picking up something and putting it in a jar. Okay, all these positions which are going to involve the supination position, pronation, you have to make out some kind of activities for the patient, and you have to make them do the activities. Okay, for fine movements, you can ask the patient to do a key lock. You can ask the patient to zip, unzip. Okay, all these are things that you can ask the patient to do. The prognosis, mostly as the researchers are there, the results are going to be more on the functional part. You're going to have more improvement in the function and less in the range of motion, but it is not very important. Functionally, the patient will improve. The improvement will be in the pain and discomfort region, but not much improvement in the range of motion.